I want to talk about a little young boy. We'll frame this moment in 1915, and this 40-year-old little boy was milling about the second floor of a dirty, dingy little apartment above a convenience store. He had to do this because his father couldn't keep a consistent job. His father was an alcoholic, and a lot of his critics would say a raging alcoholic. I don't know the difference between the two, but it was probably not very healthy. On many of these days, they used to call this young man Little Fat Dutch Boy because he was blonde. He had a haircut that was sort of, they put a bowl on your head and they cut your hair. And he was a very precocious young man, a very ambitious young little boy. But they traveled a lot of different places. But he had a mother that anchored his early childhood with the faith of God, anchored it with an indestructible belief in God and God's grace, mercy, and love. Many would say that his mother stayed with his father because of that one deep reason. This young boy would grow up to be the captain of his football team in high school, as well as college, as well as the swim team. So he had a lot of ambition. But life didn't go that well, and he found himself in an odd number of jobs after college. He would dig ditches, he would plaster walls, he was a bricklayer. And then he got a little break as a support for helping the radio broadcast of the Chicago Cubs. Now that seems exciting, but this wasn't the Cubs in Chicago. This was in Des Moines, Iowa, where he'd get to call the Cub games via a ticker tape that was about 15 minutes delay. So this was like getting third-hand baseball radio broadcast. Life wasn't quite meeting to the ambition of this young man. On a Cubs trip out to California to their training ground in Catalina Island, I don't know if many of you know that, he fell in love with the state and he decided, I'm going to do something here with my life because it was going nowhere in Des Moines, Iowa. He thought he'd get in the acting business or Hollywood and related, but that didn't really go that well, and he got drafted into the Army in World War II. And the Army used him to make 400, and that's correct, 400 Army training films. Everything from tying your shoe to putting on your flight vest to changing a spare tire to digging a latrine. So again, not the stardom that he was looking for, but it was a job nonetheless. The irony of the whole moment was in one of these films, someone fired a gun next to his right ear, and he lost most of the hearing in his ear for the rest of his life. He tried to make a living again in California doing a lot of different things, and the acting career kind of was hit or miss. And then he found himself embroiled in the union labor disputes in California. And he decided that he would become a union boss or a union leader, and he led the Screen Actors Guild for a number of years. He learned the sort of political wrangling of what it's like to lead a large group of people. But that in itself didn't go very far. But by the end of this term, he, this little Dutch, as they would call him, became the most powerful Democrat in Hollywood. The next 10 years would be very difficult on this young man as he found himself in the middle of a divorce, a lot of philosophical changes, a lot of upheaval in his life. And by the end of this period, all he could do was find a job doing the General Electric Theater for 8 solid years. It was a kind of a secondhand sort of television career that had him speaking over and over again, maybe 14 to 15 times a day. What was God doing in the middle of all that monotony? What about all those 400 films? What about all those ditches dug? What about that life that didn't go as well as he thought it was going to go? He tried his hand at the political world. He had 2 major losses in his life. But in 1980, Ronald Reagan became the 40th president of the United States. What was really unique is 2.5 years into his administration, there was an assassination attempt on his life. This bullet lodged a mere 10 centimeters from his heart, and he nearly died. He lost a tremendous amount of blood. His career hasn't even gotten started. And there's a famous story that Reagan later writes in his memoirs where he was in the hospital awaiting the doctors to perform surgery, trying to remove the bullet, where he's staring at the roof of this hospital. And while staring there, he's praying to God again. You see, he grew up as what he would call a polite Presbyterian, always sort of asking God, always sort of needing God, always it was a more of a one-way street with God. And many of us find our own selves like that in our life when things are very difficult in our life. But he was just sitting there staring at that ceiling tile, and he was praying to God. A conviction flooded him. And let me read it to you in his own words. He said, as I lay there awaiting surgery, I focused on that ceiling tile above me, praying to God. And that conviction came upon me in that moment which flooded me. How could I ask for God for something when I had so much hatred for the lost boy who had shot me? We are all like sheep who have gone astray. So I prayed for this young man to find his way back to the fold. God was asking Ronald Reagan in that one moment to not necessarily think about himself as he had done in the past, but start thinking about the one who had actually tried to harm him. Because God knew, God already loved Ronald Reagan. God already knew that, and God was asking him to trust that in that process, that he would take care of him, but to pray for the man, the young man that had shot him. And in that one huge epiphany of Ronald Reagan's life, he told his children that God had spared him for a purpose. Maybe a life of pursuing, wanting, ambition, to a life of now giving and giving back to God. What had God called Ronald Reagan to do? Ronald Reagan took everything, the misfortune and things that he had in his life, and he turned them into the very skills that Ronald Reagan was born with, to communicate, to relate, and over the process of that time, he dedicated himself to the purpose of Christ, and he helped change the world. He gained a relationship with the Soviet Union, a nuclear arms deal, and then later, the complete destruction and dissolution of Eastern Bloc communism, as well as the Russian republics. Ronald Reagan goes down in our history as one of the five most popular presidents that has ever lived, but it came in a moment where God said, it's not about you taking from me, it's about you giving back to all that I have given you. And we thank you for that, for hearing, getting to listen to these every single week. I know that they've inspired me. I hope that they get to inspire you. Ronald Reagan found fulfillment in his life by giving away from his life. We invite you to give this morning as you remember these stories. The most simple way to give to our church is through our PushPay application. If you're going to give this morning through that application, simple and easy, you just text us to 77977, and in that memo portion, you just put EN City Church. Walk through the prompts. It's very easy to give. You can also go onto our everynationcitychurch.com website and push the plans to give, and it'll walk you through the steps. And again, week after week after week, we thank you for those. Many times a week, people would come and send in checks to our office, and we thank you so much for giving. Without that, we couldn't get to do the things we get to do and touch the people we get to touch, help the many churches that we get to support, and help in this time of great need. God bless you.